How fast and how fat were dinosaurs? This is a lecture in tribute to Robert McNeill Alexander. Welcome to the Natural History of Dinosaurs. My name is Benjamin Berger. I'm a paleontologist at Utah State University, teaching in the heart of Utah's dinosaur country in Vernal. So Robert McNeill Alexander recently passed away in March of 2016, and I thought it was appropriate that I talk about some of his research on dinosaurs, particularly from the point of view of someone who studied the functional design of animals and the biomechanics of animal locomotion. One of the earliest books I read on dinosaurs was a book called Dinosaurs of Dinosaurs and Other Extinct Giants. And in this book, he looked at the biomechanics of dinosaurs as living, breathing creatures, and he used physics and the study of living animal locomotion to bring them back to life. Two of the questions he attempted to tackle in the book was how fat, that is, how big were the dinosaurs, and how fast were the dinosaurs. So I thought it would be cool to talk about these two topics at this point in the class. So first, let's look at how he calculated how much dinosaurs weighed. Now, taking the formula for weight, which is mass times gravity, and gravity on Earth is 9.8 meters per second squared, while the mass is the density multiplied by the volume. So if we want to know the weight of a dinosaur, we need to know the density and volume of the dinosaur. So here's how Robert McNeill Alexander calculated the weight of a dinosaur. First, he went to the store and he purchased a chicken. Now, a chicken is a close relative to dinosaurs, and then he calculated the density of the chicken meat by measuring both the weight and volume of the chicken, and then using algebra to find the density, which turned out to be about 0.89 to 0.81 specific density. Then he went down to the toy store in the museum and he purchased a dinosaur toy, and he dropped that toy in a glass of water. And he determined the volume by measuring the amount of water that was displaced, or the rise on the side of the glass. And then he took this measurement and he scaled it to a full-sized dinosaur. And now he had both the density and the volume for dinosaurs. And he multiplied these two numbers together and with gravity, and he got the weight of various dinosaurs. Now today people have advanced the study using fancy computer models of laser scan skeletons, but Alexander's estimates were the first to use this very simple way of estimating the weight of dinosaurs. Now, another contribution he made was in determining the running speeds of dinosaurs. We've mentioned that the stride length increases the faster an animal runs. Since stride length is a function of how big the dinosaur is, you can look at the ratio of stride length to leg length to get what is called a dynamic similarity. This ratio removes the effect of size and allows you to compare stride lengths between different dinosaurs, different sizes of dinosaurs. Now, in 1976, Alexander took these measurements from lots of different animals and he calculated a formula for calculating the running speeds of dinosaurs. Now, his formula requires knowing the hip height. This is determined from the fossilized skeletons of dinosaurs, and the stride length, determined by measuring dinosaur trackways. Now, Alexander's formula is not the only one out there, and there are other formulas for measuring running speeds from tracks and hip heights. So here's some of the running speeds that Alexander calculated for dinosaurs. Note that his estimates of Tyrannosaurus rex was around 20 kilometers an hour, which is less than the top speed of humans, but more than a simple walk. A sprinter, a really good training sprinter, could outrun a Tyrannosaurus rex, but some dinosaurs he found were really, really built for speed, including the nimble ornithomimids. All right, you should now be able to show how you can calculate both the weight and speed of dinosaurs using some of the simple science devised by R.N. Alexander.